Audible Studios presents Startupland, how three guys risked everything to turn an idea into a global business. Written by Mikkel, Svane and Carlye Adler. Narrated by Christopher Price. For the citizens of Startupland. Foreword by Alexia Sotsis. For the citizens of today's startup land, anything is possible. You can order a car, a sandwich, and even a drone from your phone. You can even subscribe to an on-demand service that manages all of your other on-demand services. As incumbent companies across all sectors continue to value immediate financial returns over innovation, our VC-backed pocket of the universe continues to throw money at small startups trying to solve big problems or small problems. Silicon Valley can at times seem like an entirely different planet, startup land. While the back of the napkin statistic is that 90% of startups never make it out of startup land, we're all struggling in overpriced housing and office buildings, hoping to be in the narrow part of the bell curve. It's only a bubble if it bursts, we whisper to ourselves while we click away at our keyboards. Chronicling his entrepreneurial journey from the first internet bubble to the current period of exuberance, Mikkel Svane's Startup Land is a unique tale of a Dane who just wanted to demystify enterprise software with his accessible, design-savvy help desk in the cloud. I most likely met Svane at one of the multitudes of startup launch parties or at a ubiquitous conference cocktail hour, but I got to know him the best as the subject of an on-stage interview I conducted at Le Web 2012, a full year after I had written a post describing the $3.4 billion SAP SuccessFactors acquisition as boring. What impressed me the most about Svane was his reluctance to show fear when asked about Salesforce's assistly buy, which within a month would be turned into the Salesforce Zendesk competitor desk.com. He also indicated in the interview that Zendesk had had an acquisition offer for $100 million, which he turned down. Bold. Svane later told me that he believed I was the voice of a generation when I called the SAP acquisition by SuccessFactors boring. Ha! But in a way, it makes sense. Svane is a big proponent of adjusting the branding of enterprise software when you're selling direct to consumers. Also, he understood what I was getting at artistically in that petty, controversial post. You cannot build a successful next-generation enterprise company without appealing to the people doing the buying nowadays, the normals. Zendesk was a vanguard company in this regard. Starting out in Copenhagen, Denmark, Svane has gone from running a 3D magic eye software startup to a forums company called Kaput, to Thank You Machine, the company that eventually became Zendesk, to taking Zendesk public with its elegant New York Stock Exchange symbol, $Zen. Svane and his co-founder Morten Primdahl came up with the idea for a help desk that you'd love while working at the big German corporate conglomerate Materna. Like my characterization of the SAP SuccessFactors buy boring was Morten's initial response to being offered a job at the huge company. Later, when Svane tried to enlist Alexander Agassipour along for his Zendesk idea, essentially a more streamlined version of Materna's offerings, he got a similar response, the most boring thing ever. Svane distills these reactions as an actual green light for a good startup idea. Pick an overlooked industry, something that someone else would find mundane, and go all out. After all, that specific boring idea, Zendesk, is now valued at over $1 billion. For Svane, the mundane is sexy if you can make something that looks hard seem easy. He and Box's Aaron Levy are the co-captains of the sexy enterprise. Svane sprinkles his chronological narrative with unexpected business advice for founders, a user's guide to Startupland. He will teach you how to get over a fear of flying by watching YouTube videos on turbulence or explain why you shouldn't party hard on your IPO roadshow, a pro tip given to him by Twitter CEO Dick Costolo. And as a model startup citizen, Svane has been through every gritty aspect of entrepreneurship, and entrepreneurs just starting out would be wise to study his journey. No moment is too humbling in startup life. Taking out a $50,000 line of credit with no savings in order to make payroll and lying to your family through economic instability, startups, even when successful, are not pretty. And it's often hard to separate press-driven mythology from the reality. Many startups constantly compare their turbulent story to the success parade often featured in our blog, TechCrunch. Bootstrapped in the beginning, Zendesk gets rejected from the TechCrunch 20 conference and even has my former boss, Mikkel personally telling Svane to never email us again. The startup eventually wins a Crunchy for sexiest enterprise startup. Long story short, they eventually get covered on TC, although not exactly in the way they had hoped. Zendesk raises prices, pisses off customers, reads one headline. And an aside, Svane once had a great time at the TechCrunch August Capital Party, so we're not that bad. Despite what you read on TechCrunch, an entrepreneur's journey is tumultuous, heartbreaking, and at times hilarious. And when you do meet a VC who likes you, well, more money, more problems. This book is a poignant recounting of the founder's kismet interspersed with offbeat advice like, unless you are Steve Jobs, CEOs are not supposed to allude to recreational drug use. Startup Land is your passport to our silly and serious startup microcosm. Enjoy your trip. Let us be lovers. We'll marry our fortunes together. I've got some real estate here in my bag. So we bought a pack of cigarettes and Mrs. Wagner's pies and walked off to look for America. Kathy, I said as we boarded a Greyhound in Pittsburgh, Michigan seems like a dream to me now. It took me 4 days to hitchhike from Saginaw. I've come to look for America. Laughing on the bus, playing games with the faces, she said the man in the gabardine suit was a spy. I said, be careful, his bow tie is really a camera. Toss me a cigarette, I think there's one in my raincoat. We smoked the last one an hour ago. So I looked at the scenery, she read her magazine, and the moon rose over an open field. Kathy, I'm lost, I said, though I knew she was sleeping. I'm empty and aching, and I don't know why. Counting the cars on the New Jersey Turnpike, they've all come to look for America. All come to look for America. All come to look for America. Paul Simon, America. Introduction. The Pursuit of Happiness. Less than a decade ago, my friends Alexander Agassipour and Morten Primdahl and I were gainfully-ish employed and unfulfilled. Though life in Copenhagen was good, everything was taken care of in the place with the happiest people in the world, we wanted to do something else with our lives. Perhaps we were each experiencing a midlife crisis of sorts. We were all in our mid to late 30s, and concerned the time was running out to do something we really wanted to do. We felt that we needed to make a change before it was too late. We all know that people grow more risk-averse over time. As we start to have houses and mortgages, and kids and cars, and schools and institutions, we start to settle. We invest a lot of time in relationships with friends and neighbors, and making big moves becomes harder. We become less and less willing to just flush everything down the drain and start all over. If we don't do this now, we'll end up as butt-cheek consultants, said Morten. He's probably the only person in the world to use that term, an allusion to the common scalloped curtains called butt-cheek curtains that hang in ordinary Danish homes. Morten didn't want to be ordinary or pedestrian. He had a fear of forever being a hired gun on projects, rather than somebody who builds something and defines his own destiny. "That is not where happiness comes from," he said. He was right. And so, in the pursuit of happiness, we turned an overlooked idea into an opportunity. In the process, we figured out how to chase, and ultimately catch, the American dream. For me, it was tough to try to preserve that little cocoon I had established for my family while moving them across the world. I feared that if we didn't succeed, it would be so much work to move back and start over. But along the way, that fear subsided. I saw how willingly Americans take on risk and accept starting all over. There's much more mobility in the United States than in Europe, and there's less nostalgia in terms of where you are and what you have. Sometimes it's almost beautiful in its brutality, the American willingness to slash everything and start over again. But that is how big things are built and great things are done. Kill your darlings. Clean slate. Rinse. Reboot. Maybe it's because the United States is a younger country and most people here are well connected to its brief history. They celebrate the independence and entrepreneurialism and grit on which this country was built, and they imbibe it. They know that if something has to be done, it will have to be done by the person in the mirror. There's nobody else. Sometimes, in thinking about our own discoveries and what we found in America, I think about one little story of Christopher Columbus as I learned it in school in Denmark. According to the legend, Columbus was back after discovering the Americas and having a meal with his friends, or maybe his enemies. One of these haters dissed his achievements, commenting that it wasn't so exceptional. After all, Spain had a lot of great men knowledgeable in cosmography and literature, and with time, anyone could have gone on a similar adventure and accomplished what he did, or so the hater said. Instead of responding to the slight, Columbus gave a demo. He requested a whole egg, placed it on the table, and issued a challenge. "My lords, I will lay a wager with any of you that you are unable to make this egg stand on its end, as I will do without any kind of help or aid." Of course, all the Spanish nobles tried and failed. Then Columbus tapped the egg gently on the table to break it slightly and stood the egg on its end. And so he made his point. Once you know, or are shown, how to do something, it's easy. The hard part is getting there. We were not the first to build an internet company, or the first to discover California as Startupland, or the first to invent customer support. Other pioneers did that before us and showed us a path. What we did at Zendesk was find a new way to do other things that hadn't been considered or tried before. Things that seem simple now, but that simply weren't done. However, we didn't succeed only because it was a good idea. After all, anyone can have a good idea. We succeeded because we worked hard, we cracked some problems early, and we didn't give up when the weather changed, when the waters became choppy and the challenges became more daunting. We didn't wait for someone to show us how to navigate. We figured it out as we went. What we found was the joy that comes from doing something no one had thought about, from creating something out of nothing, and from making what's hard seem easy. For me, finding true Zen in building a company has been the realization that almost everything is difficult. Most things are complicated. People are imperfect and don't always act rationally. Relationships are hard. If you want to make something look easy, you have to put a lot of effort into it. Only by embracing the fact that nothing is easy and that the most important things are so incredibly hard can you approach work and life with the right humility that can set you up for success. Looking back, I know that we worked hard, but most of all, I recognize that really we were also so lucky. The first few years, the fact that things didn't break apart, that was more luck than anything else. Later, it was not just about luck, but also about persistence. There are no shortcuts. You have to constantly take the hard route. I can't give a precise formula for how we built a product and then a company. After all, in some ways, I still believe it's against the odds that we succeeded. Startupland is the story of the unexpected difficulties, the unplanned occurrences, and the debates and decisions that happened in the earliest days of building Zendesk, now a global publicly traded company. It's also a story of inspiration and optimism, and an account of what you gain when you give up what you are expected to do and chart your own direction. Living and working in San Francisco, I have the opportunity to meet with aspiring entrepreneurs, and I'm often asked the same question: how did you do it? How did you move the company from Denmark to the United States? How did you get a visa? How did you get a green card? How did you get VC introductions? How do you pitch to VCs? How do you balance optimism with reality? There are no simple answers to these questions, but there are many answers. I'll try to be as honest as possible. I'll attempt to answer these challenges by detailing our own meandering, up and down and back and forth journey to startup land. I hope that our story inspires you on your journey. I'll tell you about what led to the idea and why we left comfortable lives to take a risk and pursue it. I'll share with you how we built a founding team and how we stayed together even though we didn't always get along. I'll share our mishaps with almost investors and our virginal fear of the venture capital model and how we overcame it. I'll write about our move across the Atlantic, our false starts, and the big event of becoming a public company and how that just becomes the beginning of a new story. But that's just a small part. Our mistakes get as much play as what we've mastered. I hope that what I tell you here will also show you that it wasn't all bad, and it wasn't all difficult, and that it was always worth it. I'll tell you about building a product that customers love, and how we connected with and won customers in the most unexpected corners of the world. I'll include how we built a team with friends, dear longtime friends, with whom we got to share time, a cold suburban house, and a fantastic opportunity. I'll tell you about how other friends invested in Zendesk and saved us from nearly going broke. I'll tell you what we did to disrupt the entire customer service and support industry and how we ultimately transformed an idea into a global company that's traded on the New York Stock Exchange. Along the way, I'll share the unconventional advice you learn only in the trenches. I am allergic to pat business advice that aims to give some formula for success. I've learned there is no formula for success. The world moves too fast for any formula to last, and people are far too creative, always iterating and finding a better way. A better mousetrap is always possible. But of course, there are things we've learned through experience, unexpected things. Take the value of adding spelling errors to emails in increasing customer response rates, the important practice of cursing around job candidates, or the upside of using a woman's name instead of a man's in customer correspondence. I hope that what we've learned may help you on your own path, or at the very least encourage you to think differently from the standard business-as-usual practices. Most of all, I hope that you'll agree that this is a story about fostering fulfilling relationships. I'll share how our friendships survived as we changed, how our customers grew with us and motivated us, and how our families stuck with and supported this crazy adventure. Building something out of nothing is not easy, but nothing that is worthwhile is easy, and nothing is more fun. Being a part of technology startup in San Francisco has been the most rewarding professional experience I've ever had. I wish for everyone to have that privilege of truly finding and trying what you're best at and succeeding. Chapter 1. The Honeymoon. Believing that what you're doing is great and knowing nothing of what's to come. In March 2014, most of the publicly listed high-growth technology and software-as-a-service, SaaS, companies started to experience large pricing corrections. some stocks lost 25% in value in a matter of weeks. Some lost 50%. The media was reporting valuations will be cut in half and calling it the twilight zone of SaaS. Mad Money and Squawk on the Street host Jim Cramer famously yelled, "The software as a disservice to your portfolio days are upon us." In Silicon Valley, people were drawing parallels to Sequoia Capital's famous RIP Good Times milestone presentation from October 2008. All of the analysts' models were ripped apart. Things were messy for tech startups and SaaS companies. At the exact same time, we were in the final stages of preparing Zendesk for going public on the New York Stock Exchange. Once again, our timing was not the greatest. But let's start with the start. The IPO and everything that came with it were all vastly different from everything that had started less than 7 years before, working in Alex's tiny loft in Copenhagen, arguing about everything and trying to turn an idea into a reality. The fact is, most of the time my entrepreneurial adventures hadn't gone very well, or at least they hadn't gone according to plan. I'm not just talking about Zendesk. I'm not a big fan of being called a serial entrepreneur. Call me old-fashioned, but nobody brags about how many broken marriages they have behind them. However, for better or worse, I was no stranger to startups. For most of my working life, I never had a real corporate job. Although Copenhagen, a city of about 1 million people, in a country with the smallest private sector in Europe, isn't exactly the epicenter of the startup world, it was what I knew. Beautifully simple, round one. After I graduated from business school in the early 1990s, right when a recession hit, job opportunities were scarce. I hardly even looked for employment. Instead, I pursued something I was interested in, making things on computers, and started a small graphic desktop publishing company. At the time, I was fresh out of school, and 3D magic eye books with illusions that allow you to see 3D images by focusing on 2D patterns were the fad. I created an algorithm to create these types of 3D images or visual illusions called stereograms. I had serious headaches while working on this, but I loved being able to adjust my eyes to see the 3D element instantly. Then I turned that into a computer software program that made it easy for users to make these complex illusions. This was my first formal foray into software, but the software industry was in such a different state then and had little in common with what we know today. Consumers and businesses had not begun to use the internet, and software was kept on disks and used on desktop computers. There weren't any best practices for how to distribute software, and I was a one-man software shop, figuring it out along the way. I took the packages to little computer shops to stock and sell. Customers sent me orders, and I shipped out the disks myself. I worked out of a teeny office space in downtown Copenhagen. It had low ceilings and crazy crooked floors. There were parts of the office where I couldn't stand upright. There was barely any room for me, let alone space to navigate large piles of inventory. This effort didn't make me rich, but I didn't lose money. And although it was a terrible business in that it was very labor-intensive, without much monetary payoff, I also found it was very satisfying to build a product. I loved creating something and having people use it. I was eager to read the reviews and talk to users. Most of all, I loved that I had taken something that was hard and made it easy for people. This work led me to write a book that taught people how to create these complicated images. The book, which was released only in Danish, was sold in bookstores. People bought it and learned how to make these seemingly complicated images rather simply and quickly. I designed the cover for the book. It was a computer monitor with two eyeballs poking out, you know, 3D. I rendered everything in a pirated version of Strata Studio Pro and I scanned the iris from the cover of The Cure's Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me album. I was a big fan of the album. Importing the Internet from America. Although I was fascinated by computers and grew up using first a Lambda 8300, a ZX81 clone with 2 kilobytes of memory, and later an Amstrad CPC 464 with a built-in cassette tape, no one would call Copenhagen a technology haven at that time. In the early 90s, there were only metered, very expensive dial-up connections and only one internet provider, and there were very few people on the internet. This was the early days of Netscape Navigator, and the web was just becoming searchable, but I certainly didn't know where the internet was headed. However, a trip to San Francisco in 1995 made everything more clear. It was going to change everything. In San Francisco, everything related to the internet was being totally embraced. Everything was about the web. Billboards advertised companies with www addresses. My San Franciscan friends ordered food and DVDs online. The internet was a part of their daily lives. Everyone communicated saying, "Send me an email," and everybody had an email address. I experienced emailing between Copenhagen and San Francisco and having these messages arrive instantly. I couldn't believe how much smaller the world was now that it was connected by the internet. It was completely fascinating, and I couldn't help but notice the significant gap between how technology was adopted in San Francisco and how it was integrated into our lives back at home. It wasn't. Mostly what I took home from San Francisco was the sense of being at the start of something big. Today, technology is so extremely refined that it often seems to work by pure magic. You look at your iPhone and it's hard to distinguish from the supernatural, but back then it was possible to understand the web protocols and learn how to write HTML and have an idea of how to participate. You could see the path of being a creator in this new world. I felt a little bit like I had found oil on a nearby property, and I understood there was immense value in drilling it out of the ground. There were so many things to be inspired by in the United States that I wanted to take everything I saw and bring it back with me. And that's exactly what a lot of us did. When I returned to Denmark, I was obsessed with what I had experienced in California, and I wanted to recreate it. I built a portal, a website that brought information together from multiple diverse sources. This was all the craze back then, and called it forum.dk. Initially, it was almost impossible to buy domain names for a new web service. The Danish system was extremely restrictive, requiring you to document that you owned the name already. It made everything slower and more complicated than I had anticipated. Further exacerbating matters was the fact that there was still so few people on the internet in Denmark. Still, we started toying around with the portal, researching how we could produce and gather content. We struck up a partnership with a source to distribute news for free. We also went outbound and created our own content. I had guys pick up flyers from dance parties and raves, and we put the events in a database so people could see where the best ones were happening. We added community elements and chat rooms, one of the first chat rooms in Denmark. The site gathered users, and although it was not our original intention, it became very popular with teenagers. I kept a small office in the old part of Copenhagen, known for its cobblestone streets and little cafes and shops, and I worked with people who wanted to help out. They were not real employees. After all, there was no real way to pay them. It was hard to monetize this endeavor. Advertising hadn't really moved to the internet in Denmark, so that wasn't an option. Still, making money wasn't the main point. That was secondary. It was the potential that we were pursuing. To deal with the more pedestrian matters of making money, I did a variety of unglamorous jobs, including waiting tables and cleaning houses. Living the dream. Though I had no clue how to make money off this project I loved, an opportunity came along and solved that problem for me. A newspaper offered to buy Forum. We sold off the actual service, but what we had left was the software. Now, instead of being a community portal that didn't charge anything for its services, we became a software company with products to sell. The danger in riding market waves, or going kaput. Soon I discovered that there was a real market for this software. Companies wanted to have their own websites and provide community services for their users and visitors online. We rebuilt the entire product portfolio in J2EE, the most interesting and forward-looking software framework at the time, but also the most expensive in terms of software stack. We sold it on top of BEA WebLogic and Oracle RDBMS, and primarily into large media companies or web properties, but all kinds of organizations, including financial institutions, became customers. Soon this remnant of our original service turned into a real business. We named the company Kaput, which means the head in Latin. And, of course, it also sounds like kaput, or no longer working, which was kind of cute in the beginning. Kind of. But in retrospect, of course, it's a terrible, terrible name. But we were growing this in the halcyon days of the Internet. Things were both promising and exciting. Everything was working. At the same time, I was always working. I had no personal life whatsoever. From the time I woke up in the morning until I went to bed, all I did was work. The company was financed by a few angel investors, but it was funded mostly by selling the software. The dot-com boom that had swept the United States had now hit Copenhagen. We benefited from the hyper-frothy interest in all things Internet-related. I saw something that had the potential to become something much bigger. It was a lot of work, and it was also a lot of fun. And then quite suddenly, it wasn't. The dot-com crash of 2001 came as fast as the crest had. Our software was sold primarily via value-added resellers, VARs, and these companies were hit hard by the change in the tides. Media companies, a big customer base, were also brutally affected. They couldn't pay their bills, including ours. We struggled and suffered for a year as customers fell by the wayside. Relying on sales to grow our business, and without a reserve, we had no way to cushion the impact. We had to let a lot of people go. It was really tough to have to do that to people and to go on the next day as if things were normal. I had to let go of people whom I considered very good friends, people whom I felt had built the company with me. And decisions about whom to let go relied more on where we could save most rather than on what made the most sense for the business. Ironically, one of the uber-talented guys I had to let go was David Heinmeier Hansen, who later became the father of Ruby on Rails, the framework we later built Zendesk on, and a co-founder of 37 Signals, now Basecamp, which became an inspiration for a whole generation of software startups, including Zendesk. Letting people go wasn't even the worst part. There were many tough things about being in charge of the business. One time, one of our employees didn't show up for work for several days, and we couldn't understand why. This young guy had struggled with rheumatoid arthritis since his early childhood, and I later learned that the disease had somehow led to a stroke and his far too early death. I was too young and too inexperienced to know how to properly deal with the situation. Walking into his home with the police was awful. His parents lived at the other end of Denmark, and the local police there would have to visit them to properly deliver the terrible news in person. They couldn't arrive until the evening, and in the meantime, I couldn't take the parents' many, many calls. It was terrible. We all went to his funeral, or rather, what remained of the staff went, and it was good for all of us to get together and come together for this. But the very next day, I had to let more people go. Things like this, terrible things, happened, but we had to go on, and we did. There were abysmal lows and epic highs and ultimately unrecoverable blows. At one point, we won a huge deal in Germany that we believed could turn everything around again. We felt hope. We were so far along. The transaction was complete, but before the reseller could pay us, he went into Chapter 11, another victim of the dot-com crash. We were out of money and out of luck. And at this point, a year after the bubble burst, we found that the business could no longer go on. We first had to wind down our activities. Eventually, we had to shut down completely. Kaput was fulfilling the prophecy of its name. I was devastated. I had just turned 30, and for almost 4 years, this was the only thing that I had done. I was not depressed about losing my livelihood. I was depressed about losing the only thing I had. In Silicon Valley, there's a lot of talk about failure. There's almost a celebration of failure. People recite mantras about failing fast, and successful people are always ready to tell you what they learned from their failures, claiming they wouldn't be where they are today without their previous spectacular mess-ups. To me, having experienced the disappointment that comes with failure, all this cheer is a little odd. The truth is, in my experience, failure is a terrible thing. Not being able to pay your bills is a terrible thing. Letting people go and disappointing them and their families is a terrible thing. Not delivering on your promises to customers who believed in you is a terrible thing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.